Having seen the approximation of statically computed data flow value, having seen the approximation in a statically computed data flow value, in terms of what it represents, in terms of the runtime value that it represents, it's time for us to formalize this notion. We want to first begin by formally specifying what is the meaning of dynamic behavior of a program at a program point. So the dynamic behavior, the runtime behavior of a program at a program point is represented by a set of states S. Each state is denoted sigma, reaching a program point along all execution traces or all along all execution path. So each execution path brings a state at a program point, and because there could be multiple execution paths reaching a program point, we have a set S of states sigma. Each state sigma consists of two parts. The first part is a standard semantics, which is represented by the concrete values of variables at runtime. And the second part is instrumented semantics, which represents other relevant properties that cannot be derived from the values of variables. These include, for example, liveness of variables or availability of expressions, etc. So let's look at an example of states along a trace, along a particular execution path. So we have a control flow graph here, and we're going to talk about a path 1, 2, and then 3, 2, which is one traversal of the loop, again 3, 2 for the second traversal of the loop, again 3, 2 for the third traversal of the loop, and after the third traversal of the loop, the control flows to 4 and then to 5 and then to 6. So this is an example path that we have chosen, and we assume some values at the start of the path. We assume that A is 5, B is equal to 2, C is equal to 7. There's nothing particularly special about these values. Any value would be good enough in order to illustrate the point that we wish to make. So given this value at the start of a trace or an execution path, a trace is a representation of an execution path, we denote the set sigma reaching the start entry of a node, the start of a node, like this. So at the start of one, node 1, the value of A is 5, B is 2, and C is 7, which is by the assumption that these are the values of the variables at the start of the program. This is the standard semantics, and in the instrumented semantics for the available expressions, we say that no expression is available. Here we have the first bit representing the expression A mod 2, the second bit representing the expression B less than C, the third bit representing the expression B greater than C, and the last bit representing the expression B plus 1. Now, after execution of node 1, the state reaching the start of 2 is the following. The value of A remains unmodified. We are talking about this program point. The value of B has been modified. How has it been modified? B is made negative of the absolute value of B. So B was 2 earlier, now it becomes minus 2. And C is A mod 2, A was 5, so therefore 5 mod 2 is 1. So that's the standard semantics, the values of the variables reaching the start of 2. And we note that the first expression, the expression A mod 2, has been computed here and is not preceded by a definition of any of its operands. So the instrumented semantics is 100. At the start of node 3, which is when we come from here, we observe that the values remain same because node 2 does not modify the values. However, the second expression, which is B less than C, becomes available at the start of node 3. After the execution of node 3, we go back to node 2, and in node 2, the value of b has been incremented by 1, so b becomes minus 1, and because b has been modified, obviously expression b plus 1 is not available, but b less than c expression that was available along this path ceases to be available, so we have the instrumented semantics is 100. So like this we can find out the state at each program point along this particular execution path. And because there could be multiple execution paths, we could have multiple states reaching each program point. So we now set up two worlds, concrete world and abstract world. Concrete world is what is called collecting semantics, because we are collecting information along all possible traces. And in the abstract world, in the compile time world, we have abstract semantics, which is represented by a lattice with a partial order weaker than relationship. And this is a concrete world, which is represented by a set 2 raised to capital sigma with a superset order. What does this mean? So, collecting semantics at a program point U is represented by a set which is a subset of capital sigma, which is a universal set of all possible states. So, we talk about all these states sigma contained in the set S reaching U along all traces. And abstract semantics at a program point is represented by a data flow value which is D in L. So we have S in 2 raised to sigma and we have D in L. And here we assume at the start of the program no state reaches. So this is the top value, the empty set of states is the top value, and as we go down the lattice we accumulate more and more states in a set, and at the bottommost S is sigma, which is all possible states. So we have a lattice here on the left and we have a lattice here on the right, and the lattice on the right is an abstraction of the real world. So the data flow values that we compute are here, and these represent the actual runtime information. Now we define two functions, abstraction function and concretization function. An abstraction function takes a set of states S and abstracts it out. This function is denoted alpha. So this point here in this lattice is denoted alpha S, abstraction function alpha applied to a set of states S. This is an abstraction function. We also have, so an abstraction function gives the data flow value representing a given set S of states. So we have this function going from concrete world to abstract world. We have the converse function also, which goes from an abstract world to a concrete world, and as we would expect, it's called a concretization function denoted gamma. So let's take a data flow value D from abstract world and apply the concretization function gamma, and it gives us a set of states which is computed by applying gamma to D. So this is gamma D. This is a concretization function which gives us the meaning of a data flow value. Meaning of a data flow value in terms of the semantics that it represents. So we have an abstract value. That abstract value corresponds to certain concrete values. So gamma of D gives us the set of all possible values that this abstract value could represent. So a concretization function gives a set of states represented by a given data flow value D. As we observed that each state sigma consists of two parts, standard semantics and instrumented semantics. a particular analysis may not be interested in both standard semantics as well as instrumented semantics. So we define something called a representation function beta for an analysis, which reads a state sigma and extracts the part of the state that is relevant to the analysis. For example, for available expressions analysis, beta sigma returns the instrumentation semantics in sigma, representing the expressions that are available, representing the set of expressions that are available. For live variables analysis, beta sigma returns the instrumentation semantics in sigma, representing the set of variables that are live. For constant propagation, beta sigma returns the standard semantics in sigma, representing the values of variables. We can give a mathematical signature of a beta function, but it would be a little complicated, so therefore I have not shown here on the slides. Now let's look at the set of data for values for available expressions analysis. The reason why we are doing that is we want to understand the mapping between concrete values and abstract values. So we have a set view of the lattice here, where our top value is the universal set of expressions, assuming that we have three expressions. Our top value is the universal set containing these three expressions, and at the second level we have sets containing two expressions. At the third level we have sets containing only one expression, and at the fourth level we have the empty set, which is a set containing no expressions. This is because our partial order is a subset relation. As we go down these lines, what we get is a subset. The one at the lower end of the line is a subset of the element at the higher end of the line. So we denote this as something that's going down is weaker, so x is weaker than y. And we can have a bit vector view where we have these three expressions represented by 1 1 1, these two 1 1 0 1 0 1 0 0 1, etc., and the bottom value is 0 0 0. So how do we set up lattices? So for available expressions analysis, we set up a lattice such that the top element is the universal set and bottom element is the empty set. For live variables analysis, we do it the other way around. The top is the empty set and the bottom is the universal set. That's because for live variables analysis, our meet operation is a superset operation. As we go down a line like this, as we go down this relation, this is a superset of this, and this is a superset of this. Here, this is a superset, a subset of this, and this is a subset of these two. So that's the duality between the way we set up lattices in available expressions analysis and for live variables analysis. In case of available expressions analysis, recall that our meet operation is the set intersection, whereas in case of live variables analysis, the meet operation is set union. The important thing is that we choose an orientation such that the result of the confluence, in this case the meet operator, appears below the two operands that it is applied to, or the weaker than relation takes us down the lattice. The advantage of doing that is then we can talk about data flow analysis in general without worrying about whether it's an all path problem or an any path problem. We always talk about a meet operator, and then we say our meet operator is sometimes set intersection and sometimes set union. So this generalization is very, very useful.